email out of the way. Just wondering if the panel could better explain exactly what this verse is referring to. They're speaking of Proverbs chapter 16, verse 4. Proverbs chapter 16, verse 4. And I'll ask them to put that on the screen. That's Proverbs chapter 16, verse 4. And I'll just read it real quickly right here. The Lord has made all things for himself, yes, even the wicked for the day of evil. And what they're asking is, it's that last part, even the wicked for the day of evil. I may not say this in email, but I can tell you that quicker. But they're asking, what does this mean? Did he create these people for the express purpose of doing wicked acts? And the answer is no. What the verse is just simply saying is that in God's plan, there was going to be people that would rebel. That's simply it. Dealing with free will, there was going to be those who would accept and believe and those that would rebel. So it's not that he created a race of people. These are just the sinners that rebel against me. But the fact of the matter, in his foreknowledge, he knew that there would be rebellion.
All right, you can look at the phrase A of evil, the person of the evil, okay? And throughout the prophets, there is this promise that there is an evil day coming, there is a day of judgment. And God reserves not only the blessing upon the righteous, but also the judgment upon the wicked. And so in this situation, he's made all things, including the day that the wicked will be judged. I think that's the context we're going to see this.
So again, we're talking about the plan.
Yeah.
Not eternal security.
Exactly.
Well, please let
me know. It's understood that in the church today is free will versus God's providence. When things happen, people automatically say, well, it must have been God's will. Well, God has that will, but we can resist that will.
Yeah. Well, people do it every day.
Every day. Ministers do it every day.
Christians.
So in this situation, what he's talking about, God created humanity, but he created us with a free will.
Absolutely.
If you're not down the highway 20 miles an hour over the speed limit and get pulled over and receive a ticket, that's not that policeman's fault. It isn't God's fault. It's your fault because you had a choice of either obeying or disobeying. And if you disobey, we receive the consequences.
Pastor,
Paul said it very well.
Okay,
I don't know if I could add anything to it. I always go back to the book of Job when you talk about evil. And I also know the other scripture says, don't let a man say that he is tempted of evil, that God is the one.
Right.
For in him is no evil. And if you want to know where evil comes from, Job, the oldest, character,
yes.
He shows us without a tabernacle, without a law, without anything, only operating under the dispensation of creation and conscience, Job looks at us and says, God just sets back and lets man self-destruct. He lifts the edge. This, evil is there. That's all I had to say.
Evil is there. Evil is the predominant force in the world today. But man chooses that evil. God has sent the plan of salvation. God does not force, contrary to Calvinism, individuals to accept him. But he lovingly and openly extends grace and mercy and salvation. But it's up to the individual without coercion, without force, or violation of that person's will to accept. So that's what he's saying there in Proverbs. He's not saying I created people for evil or I created, but he's just saying the very fact that this is what I'm going to do, this is what's going to happen as well. Jewel from Missouri is our first caller today. Hello, Jewel.
Hello.
Yeah, I'm fine. What can we do for you today?
Well, I'm sorry that my player has a broken arm. I'm sitting here with a broken ankle.
this is part of, I think, a throwback to the Hebrew, when something was referred to as emphatic, in the emphatic form, it's repeated. For example, I can say to Pastor Dupree, Dr. Dupree, Shalom, and that means God's blessing on you. It's also hello, by the way. It's also goodbye. It's, sometimes I don't know if they're coming or going, but it's basically peace of God. If I say shalom, shalom, the literal translation is the everlasting peace of God beyond you. You see the difference, I would say. It's a form, it's an emphatic form that brings more power to it. When you say amen, you're saying I agree with that, let it be done. When you say amen and amen, you're putting a double emphasis on that, and you're calling God to see that it's done.
Praise the Lord. I just think it's, in my opinion, for people of the Bible, that's a Bible term.
Absolutely.
It's not something you find at Walmart or anywhere else. You don't say, come and pick up your package over here at this department. Amen. This is a term of the Bible. And people who live by the Bible, I trace it home to where, I mean, you know, mom would say things like, I would say, how come they're allowed to do this, but we're not allowed to do it? Mom said, you think I'm going to be like Eli? Let you do what you want to do if I want to cut your neck? I mean, people who live by the Bible treat characters of the Bible, terminology of the Bible. It becomes woven into your vocabulary, woven into your life. And I might say at home, I might say, amen, 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 and amen. Because that means it's so be it.
It's established.
I just think it's wonderful. We even sing songs in our little Kentucky church that just said amen, amen, amen. You know, it's part of who we are.
It's just it's an affirmation, Joel, of our agreement to what is being preached, what is being said, whatever the case. And so I hope that answers the question for you.
Yeah, I'm calling it was just the man so big, you know, but that he needs to hear me all. I thank you for your answers, and I pray you just have a blessed day.
Thank you, Joel. Scott from Florida, you're on the air. Scott? Yes, you're on the air. What is your question?
Hi, I'm one of the first to mention that I am a Trinitarian, but my dad, however, is not. And scripture he likes to go to when I'm going to have our discussion is John chapter 17, verse 3, where Christ says, I'm quoting from the NIV, it says, now this is eternal life, that they know you, speaking to the Father, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. And I'm just wondering how I could better answer him on that.
Well, first of all, we have to go back to the beginning. Book of Genesis.
Okay.
The Bible said, let us go down and make man in our image. That's plural. You can't get any plainer than that. Next, there are three that bear record in heaven. That's what the scripture says. This whole idea of in John chapter 17, and we don't refer to gods. He's the one true God, manifest in three distinct personalities: God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. So when he says that you might know the only true God in Jesus Christ, he is just including two of the Trinity there. It can't be any plainer than that. I would tell your dad that scripture must prove scripture. So you have to go back from the beginning and look at this. When the Lord in the gospel and led his earthly ministry, he would make it very clear, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. He was not saying, I'm the Father. But he was saying, I am one sent by the Father. I am the one who will carry out the Father's will as it regards atonement day. And
how we know the Father is because of the work of Christ on the cross that made real to us by the Holy Spirit. No one can come to the Father except the Holy Spirit draws
him. So that you see,
they all work together.
Okay, Scott, you look at it this way. Look at this what Brother Dave said, how man is saved. There is no one that has ever been a child of God that was not first quickened in their spirit by the Holy Spirit. He is the convictor. Jesus said to himself in the book of John, he will reprove, that means rebuke, the world of sin, or convict the world of sin. Secondly, he convicts them and brings them to a knowledge of Jesus Christ. I'll put it this way. The only way to the Father is through the Son, and the only way to the Son is as the Holy Spirit draws you.
That's right.
So you see the divine Trinity at work there. Incarnation. And I find that a real specious argument. We're not God. We don't know the answer to everything. God has not revealed everything to us. But one day we will walk in perfect knowledge and those questions will be answered. And the end result is, what does it matter? As far as we're concerned, what does it matter? Because what matters to us is that God became flesh, was born of a virgin, lived a perfect life, died on the cross to atone for the sins of man, spent 3 days in a tomb, and on the third day, he was resurrected on a living. Guarantee and validate our salvation. Our salvation is a perfect salvation because it was based on a perfect sacrifice and even a perfect death and a perfect resurrection. So, but people get caught up, Scott, in all of these religious arguments, and it's all of the devil. It's all of the devil to keep people's minds rotating on that and really pushing aside the rest of the gospel. There's just some things, Scott, I would tell people, we're not meant to know in this life. So what is the point of wasting time and energy of trying to figure out something that God is not going to reveal to us until we're in a state of perfect knowledge? And then he won't have to reveal it because we will know it automatically.
So we'll see him.
Yeah, we will
be like him.
We will be like him. And last I checked, he had perfect knowledge.
You know, Pastor Donnie, you mentioned John chapter 1. If you go back to Genesis chapter 1 verse 2, and it said the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the earth. And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the water. So we see the Spirit of God referred to in Genesis chapter 1 and verse 2. We see Jesus referred to as part of creation in John chapter 1. And this passage that he refers to in John chapter 17 is Christ praying in his ministry as faithful and merciful high priest. Now, if you look at the intercession that Jesus makes in John chapter 17, then you take it over to Romans chapter 8 and verse 34. It said, who is he that condemned? Is it Christ that died rather than just risen again? Who is even at the right hand of the Father making intercession for us? So Romans 8:34 references Christ sitting at the right hand of the Father.
So Brother Donnie brought up John chapter 1:1. And one of the major reasons why John wrote the Gospel of John was because the deity of Christ, by the time he wrote it, all of the other apostles had passed away. John was the last one who died of natural causes. But when he was writing this, it was because even in the church, they were questioning the deity of Christ. So John starts off his gospel with, en arche en halakos. En arche means whenever time began, he already was. Whenever you think time began, the word already existed. If you go to the History Channel, Discovery Channel, and try to figure out how old the earth is, they never agree. And there's hundreds of millions of years in between each one. They never agree. But whenever you think time began, John said, Jesus already was. The Word already was. The pre-existence of Christ means that he was not created in the sense that the world was created. So in our day, in our logos, in this word, kakalagos, in cross, tantheon, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So the deity of Christ, and this is important, this is all part of the Trinity. If you're into monism, which was Sidney's came up with that, the idea that he can operate only in one person at a time, that's what disregarded the baptism of Jesus. We have God the Father speaking from heaven. This is my beloved Son, who I'm well pleased. Again, if you're oneness, this is my Son, and who I'm well pleased. That doesn't make sense. We have Jesus coming out of the water, so that's two. Then you have the Holy Spirit coming out like a dove. So all three are present there, and it totally goes against monism.
Oh, that's helped you, Scott.
If I
Thank you so much for your time, guys, and may you all be blessed.
Thank you, thank you. Our next email, please explain 1 John chapter 3, verses 8 through 10. 1 John chapter 3, 8 through 10. Let me read it, and then I'll read the question that he asked. Verse 8, he who commits sin is of the devil, for the devil sinned from the beginning. For this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Whoever is born of God does not commit sin, for his seed remains in him, and he cannot sin, because he is born of God. In this the children of God are manifest, and the children of the devil. Whosoever does not righteousness is not of God, neither he who loves not his brother. So here's the question. Please explain 1 John 3, 8 through 10. Why does it say that we cannot sin? Well, the word cannot there should be, actually, Greek scholars will tell you it's the word practice. While a believer, they can, as a believer, we're not perfect. We don't have sinless perfection, and we will fail the Lord at times, but we do not practice sin. That's the whole idea in the meaning of that particular statement, gentlemen.
Habitually continue in sin without repenting.
Exactly right.
Well, it's been in the church for many years. People will try to see how much of the world they can enjoy but still have enough of Jesus to get to heaven. And we can't do that. We need to be doing everything within us to live for Christ daily.
The idea is also, a true believer doesn't want to sin.
Yes.
But we don't get up in the morning and say, you know, today, maybe one or two sins. Oh, it's so good. No. A true believer wants, when they get up every day, they want, you know, I pray this almost every day, Lord, let today my life be a living epistle, a reflection of Christ. That should be the desire of the true born-again believer. But no matter the desire, we will fail the Lord. But it doesn't mean we habitually, continually, not only sin, but we openly practice sin. That's the whole idea in that particular sin.
We don't want to. In fact, Paul said, I hate it.
And that's where guilt comes in. What you do, the Holy Spirit's there. He convicts. Guilt comes. And most of the time, if you know the Lord, because you're up to the Lord, know the Word well enough, you don't even have to wait for the Holy Spirit. I mean, you know, well, it's the Holy Spirit there, but you know instantly the Spirit in you, the moment you do it, the Spirit in you isn't, no. That's not going to work. And you know.
But it doesn't work so right with the Word commit both of those. Verse 8 is a present active participle, which means it's an ongoing. You're living a life of sin, and you do a lot of stuff.
Exactly.
And so in verse 9, it means that you cannot continue in a lifestyle of sin. And that's that. If you're truly born again, you don't want to continue.
There's going to be fruit.
That's right. That's right.
All right, let's go to Veda in Pennsylvania. Hello, Veda. You're on the air.
Hi. Good morning, panel. Thank you so much for your biblical explanation of so much good words throughout the Bible. I listen to you practically every single day, and yesterday, Pastor Donnie Swaggart really spoke the word. I mean, I was so blessed.
Well, thank you.
So thankful.
Thank you.
So, I had a question about 1 Corinthians 5:5. My background was extravagant, charismatic, worthy, and I left there because of some practices that I didn't find biblical, and also this practice in the church of the term moving state. I wanted to know, I know the background of why this gentleman turned over the state because he was sleeping with his father's wife.
Yeah, incest.
But I wanted to know, do pastors, like any charismatic or worthy us an opportunity to repent and just punish them with the turning over to Satan. Can they do that safely without another pastor's intervention or an elder's intervention?
Yes, they can. And it's very simple as this, that what Paul was dealing with here in the church in Corinth was a man that had been confronted. And the evidence or the idea is that he had been confronted not once or twice, but this had been an ongoing issue that he had been constantly confronted, and he was making no effort to repent of it. And he says, okay, if he's not going to repent, for the sake, and that's a paraphrase here, for the sake of the body, you have to remove him, so that he does not, that spirit of sin does not infect the church, because there's a spirit behind sin. And secondly, it shows the church that you're not taking sin seriously. So any pastor, if he sees one of his parishioners in open sin, and he's been dealing with him, saying this and that, now there's a difference between and then arrogance refusing. So there is a fine line there, but if that pastor knows that he's dealt with and dealt with and dealt with, and this individual is not making any effort to get victory over that, and is, and in essence, relishing in that, that pastor has every right and should put that person out of the flock of that local assembly for the protection of the rest of the sheep. And but if